everything is hands-on.
It's a very learner-driven experience.
It's not a competitive environment. Everyone wants to see everybody succeed. It's definitely interdisciplinary because it's real materials, real tools, real problems.
No.
No. So what do you think you can do about it?
There's not just one answer, there's many.
MAKEOVER is a nonprofit organization that's bringing making opportunities to communities.
And they are masters at bringing all of us MAKEOVER educators together.
They learn something and they teach you something. And that in turn teaches everybody else.
MAKEOVER has had a huge impact on my professional development.
The philosophy that we've been given as a part of MAKEOVER is that it's one of cross-pollination of ideas. The thing that surprised me the most about this experience is that I learned more about how I teach than what I teach.
I just see this tremendous energy in the educators when they walk away from an experience with MAKEOVER.
You're not really looking for the end product. How you get there is more important.
If kids can understand the scientific and the engineering and the math principles behind what they're making, they can change the world. I remembered letting a kid know that, you know, she'd really solved a hard problem, and this is a kid that had very low self-esteem. And then as she walked away, she sort of did a little dance. That's just like one of those moments where you realize, like, it's so small, right? And it could disappear if you don't note it, but that might stay with that child for the rest of their life. That's great.
My biggest hope for the students is for their imaginations to just run wild.
These are kids that don't look at the world as happening to them. They really look at the world as theirs to design. In the MAKEOVER community, we create,
we explore,
we learn,
and we imagine.
Hi everyone, I'm Lisa Regala with MAKEOVER, and I am joined by my colleagues, Steve Davey and Jessica Parker. So you just watched a video that hopefully showcased a little bit about what MAKEOVER as an organization does and the work that we do with educators around the country. But it also hopefully gave you a little glimpse into our philosophy around MAKEOVER education. And Steve and Jessica, since you've both worked in K-12 settings for many years, I'm curious if you could talk about how that philosophy translated into your teaching practice.
Well, I think you can see it in the body language and the joy that the children are showing, not just the children, but the teachers as well, how happy they are to be tinkering and making with something and sharing it with each other. So it's a very collaborative way of learning in the way that children naturally learn through play, exploration, and sharing what it is that they want to do with each other and getting excited by that.
That's a great point. I love also the value on the process and the potential final product or outcome, which I think is so instrumental to really diving into what learning looks like and moments of learning, not only for individual students, but also group of learners, right? I mean, what did you decide there? And why was that your choice? And then what did you learn overall? And let's reflect on that process and what can we learn collaboratively?
You have an entire context for all the other areas of subject areas in learning in what's made and in the process of how it's made. Yeah.
So thank you for that. Many of you out there probably, I know we kind of dove right in here, but many of you probably are familiar with the MAKEOVER movement and been familiar or involved in it for many years. But there might be some of you out there who aren't familiar with it, so we want to talk a little bit about the history. Basically, in 2005, Dale Doherty founded Make Magazine, and 1 year later started MAKEOVER Fairs, which were festivals, really just celebrations of what people made. He really showed that there was this need out there that people wanted to showcase what they were doing and share it with others. And that was everything from technology to crafts to woodworking. And now there are MAKEOVER Fairs and mini MAKEOVER Fairs that exist all over the world. It's really kind of grabbed on as a grassroots effort and a local community effort for people to keep creating.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the MAKEOVER movement is grassroots. It's so much more than even the fairs and the magazine, which is a great high visibility aspect of the MAKEOVER movement. Mm-hmm. But really, as we're all born makers, the whole world is full of communities that share what it is they love to do. You know, there's all sorts of gatherings that are kind of seen within this sort of, we're excited to get together and share what it is we love and to see new things that other people love. And I love that about the energy about the fair, but also this kind of happens in other places. The MAKEOVER movement is about connecting. that sort of love of what people do and what it is that they love to make, whatever that might be.
Yeah, and if we take a historical perspective, we have a long history with an education of learning by doing, arts-based curriculum, inquiry-based, kind of diving in, using our hands, getting out into the world. And so making, if you look at it from a longitudinal perspective, is has always been happening within our schools, within our educational communities, our libraries, our museums, within our own families.
That's the beautiful thing about maker education, is it's taking what we knew about education from history, combining it with this new excitement and this new energy, and kind of floating all approaches. You can make every kind of educational approach better through making, whether it's inquiry, problem, project, a design thinking process, or even instructional. Mm-hmm. All of those can be made better by something that is actually made, and to be more student-centered, so that this form of making kind of comes in collaboration with educators and students.
So I want to address the elephant in the room, and that some people, and I know I've heard it, I'm sure you all have heard it, think that the maker movement isn't very inclusive. And so I'm curious if you can comment a little bit on that.
If you view the maker movement as being solely based on maybe the magazine or high tech in particular, you're talking about some expensive things that are hard to get to. You might not have access to the internet, you might not have access to those things, or maybe you see it as a hobbyist type thing. But if you see making as inclusive as it is, the history of humanity, and we're all being more makers, then you realize that we all are makers, and you can actually invite people to the maker movement, whether they identify as a maker or not, based on what it is they love, and what it is they love to do, and would you like to share that, and are you excited about it? So I think that's a way of making it more inclusive. It's just how you see the term making, and how inviting you are about the process.
Yeah, great point. And so if we broaden that notion of making and think of it as tinkering, creating, designing, making together, then we see wonderful everyday examples within our own lives of making that happen all the time. A wonderful example that I love is really Kane's Arcade, a documentary about a young boy who actually ends up making with his father during the summertime, just with cardboard, right? And tape. It's so wonderful. And so now we have the cardboard challenge that happens every fall, in which communities and schools and libraries, you know, come together and just through cardboard to actually create with kids and adults alike. And so that process, I think, is phenomenal and talks and really extends to the inclusivity of the maker movement, and also that it doesn't have to be just high tech. It doesn't have to be just STEM. It doesn't have to just be people who have garages, right? It really is for everyone.
Yeah. He made people cry. Yes. He made people be inspired. Yeah. He made a beautiful nonprofit. Yeah. And any child, any youth has that capability to have that impact. And so this maker education is about how do we give those opportunities for the voices of children and youth to be heard, and the things that they love to do made, be shared with others in positive, sometimes transformative ways.
So it's a great lead-in to a question I'm sure everyone's anxious to hear, but I want to know what your advice would be to high schools, especially those that are just starting to embark on creating their makerspace or incorporating making into their classrooms.
That's a great question. I'll dive in. I think start with where the kids are already making, right? I mean, you're working with teenagers, right? CTE educators, you're already making. So is there a way that you can actually take what your students are doing, not only the process, but also their products, and actually showcase that? Bring in that authentic audience, whether it's parents, community members, your own colleagues, other classes, right? Whether it's the middle school or even other ninth grade or 10th grade or even other seniors there, and actually bring them in and say, let's talk about this. Why'd you pick that? What happened here when you did that? And really give them an authentic experience to share their process.
Absolutely. And look to your immediate school community. Your youth, your students are your greatest resource and collaborators. There is making going on everywhere in the school. Like Lisa and I both have a theater background. What's more interdisciplinary than a theater space? It is like a maker. It is a maker space. It's like you have acting, you've got lighting, you've got set design, you've got costumes, you've got the acting, the writing itself.
I learned to weld
music.
Through theater.
Yes,
I did.
Yeah. So if CTE educators were looking to the theater or looking to other departments, things were that are clearly being made within the school that students care about, that caring about, that connection that can be made, mm-hmm. makes students more likely to like want to be more successful in many academic areas.
Yeah, I think there's a real leadership opportunity here for CTE educators to really go and co-teach with their colleagues, right? And whether it's the theater folks or maybe the math, science, history, and English folks, come together and create those projects, those ways in, those entry points for students to dive deeply into something that's meaningful to them and important to you as well.
Likewise, the maker mentality is one of, well, I might not be the expert on this, but you as students can be. I mean, you might code me under the table, or you have things that you love to do that I don't know as an educator, but let's learn them together. And so you're modeling that curiosity and that desire to keep learning. The maker movement and the maker education kind of gives you this permission to have more of that as an educator and to learn more and deeply in collaboration with your students.
Yeah, and what it also offers is you as an educator not only to highlight those technical skills that are so needed in this day and age, but also then be able to cross that bridge and over those curricular skills, those social skills, right? Around problem solving, around critical thinking, communication, creativity that you see on a daily basis, but now you can provide and actually showcase to your colleagues, and of course to the students themselves and their parents.
And I would consider those social skills to be the most important element. How do you see yourself? What is your identity? What's your confidence? What do you bring to your community? That's huge impact, yeah. No matter what career you might go on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the great thing is that this exists in spaces of all different shapes and sizes and that invoke different learning approaches, right? And we even have a guide that talks a little bit about that.
And imagine Lucas right behind us.
It's the Makerspace Playbook. This celebrates makerspaces everywhere throughout institutions. It could be every classroom, it could be the theater, it can be the library with fabrication materials as well as ways to do research. It can be the cafeteria used as a dance space, as well as a place to build big forts. So basically, any space that enables making is a makerspace, and our Youth Makerspace Playbook helps you to identify the areas in the high school where you can have a dedicated space or perhaps mobile spaces, or even the corner of a classroom where just materials are available. And then to celebrate and enable many forms of making throughout schools in particular.
And I think why we're all here is that we really care about students. And so we want to leave you in thinking about the impact that having these types of experiences can have on students, even students that might feel disengaged in school today.
Absolutely, a sad reality. A lot of students feel checked out in school. They have problems with testing. They have anxiety over this heavy weight of academics, and they don't feel personalized.
Yeah, so they feel disconnected.
Yeah, beautiful thing is that this chance to make and the identity that you get when you make helps you in those other areas as well. And so we see this in the impact of our work. It actually changes and transforms lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we hope you'll enjoy hearing a little story about one of the teens that has been impacted by making.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, CTE educators. We love you.
I always hear like big noises in a room, and you hear a bunch of hammering and then building and drilling.
One time I was hammering something and then I was like, wait, this is a good beat. And so I started hammering random things in my lab.
What's similar between music and making is that they both have the ability of freedom. You can do whatever you want.
I'm Sasha, I'm 14 years old and I'm going to the 10th grade.
The first time that I knew I had test anxiety was in eighth grade. It was our midterm for English. And I studied really hard for it. And I just remember sitting down at the test, my hands were shaking, and I just was freaking out, and then got a really bad grade.
I was going on a trip with my family, and I remember just walking through a cave, and I see a little hole inside the cave. So I asked the cave guide, what's behind that? Is there like another room or something? He's like, we don't know. We don't want to destroy the caves. And I was like, huh, Dad, why don't we build a robot that can go inside there and scan the cave and map it out so we know if the cave is worth being destroyed for that small hole or not?
I saw Sasha building stuff. I'm like, hey, I can build stuff also.
My name's Lena. I'm 10 years old and I'm going to fifth grade.
A creative person can be anyone, I think. No one has to tell you what to do. You can just like build anything you want.
One, two, three, fire.
Right now, my mom just gave me a VCR player, and it was all broken. And right now I'm trying to take it apart and understand the components.
My name is Kai. I'm 11 years old, and I'm going to sixth grade. This is like a big problem to me. When it gets overly hard, I feel like it's not gonna be possible. I don't give up because I always know if you just keep trying, you'll get it one time at least.
Before I started the project, I felt like I wasn't the making type. I felt as if I was incapable of building something. After I built the project, I felt stronger, and that boosted me up in saying, hey, you know, I can actually do something. I feel more free when I'm making.